Okay, here is Remy. I will add him to the stream. How are you, Remy?
Fine, and you?
Very good. It's nice to have you here. I already presented you, so yes, you're ready to start. Can you share your screen?
Yes, yes. Tell me if it is okay. First time I share with two screens, but I will switch to the window. Okay.
Okay. Okay, perfect.
Okay.
Great.
Thanks. Okay. So my name is Rémi Cresson. I work with the French Institute of Environment and Agriculture. And I will present you in this presentation one software we have developed in the framework of a project we did for the French Spatial Agency. That consists in studying the different approaches to remove clouds in optical images. So since it is based on the deep learning, we had a lot of development, and we wanted to push everything in the open source. So we have developed a program. I will present you that. First, what's the context today? So you can see that we have more and more remote sensing satellites, sensors with increasing resolutions. And every day we have a continuous stream of data to process. And that's a computational challenge. And on the other end, we have a new era of data processing with the deep learning, which allows to tackle a complex problem and going large scale in an efficient manner. So it's today it's state of the art, and we can really, it's really interesting because we have all this data and the deep learning, and we can do some crazy things. So the problem we have addressed is the following. Is one of the biggest issue in the optical images, which is the clouds that pollute the image, and you cannot exploit them because they hide the information that you want. So this is a nice cloudy image acquired over the Montpellier area, which I'm from. And to tackle this issue, we had to study a few approaches in the literature. And to do that, we have developed a tool that allow to create data sets, that allow to train networks, and finally, that enforce the standards to process real-world images and remove clouds in real-world optical Sentinel image. So for now, we only target the Sentinel 1 and 2 images, but there's no doubt that other sensors can be added. And for instance, Landsat or Planet or synthetic aperture radar sensors, and a lot of things are possible, but the implemented sensors are just Sentinel for the moment. So the framework allows to do the following stuff, implement some networks, train some networks, validate them, export them in a well-known format that we can use later in the Orfeo toolbox. And TensorFlow, and of course, we use every OSDO libraries to do that, GDAL, Orfeo Toolbox, and so on. The basic steps of the application are the following. First, we have to integrate the images. This step consists basically in computing a lot of statistics on the patches images to allow the indexation of these patches, and then in the second step, we can extract these patches with a complex query. I will show you some example later, and you will see how it is made. And the first step is the model training. So you code your model, you train it, and you can perform some validation using the popular well-known metrics, namely the structural similarity, the spectral angle, the peak to noise signal ratio, and the mean square error, of course. And finally, the last step is to use your model on a real world image and process Sentinel images. The first step is the following. You have Sentinel-1 and Sentinel-2 products. You pre-process the images. So in our case, we just compute the top of canopy reflectance of the optical images, and we perform the synthetic aperture radar calibration. And we store these images in a tiled and lossless compressed format to speed up the I/O when we compute things on these images later. We compute then some statistics about the cloud percentage in patches, about the no data pixels and stuff like that. And then we index all these patches to in some R3. I will explain that later. And we export all that so we can use it later. So all this is to help the patches query. We'll see that later. The second step, so we have our pre-processed images, and we have what we call the acquisition layout. The acquisition layout is something that describes how the images are acquired in the sensor point of view. For instance, you want some optical image that is acquired near some synthetic aperture radar image in less than 24-hour gap, and with 10% cloud. Well, that's an example. I will explain that a bit later. And we use some R3 to do that. So the R3 use the dimensions, the following dimensions: cloud percentage, acquisition date, the gap to the nearest synthetic aperture radar image, and of course the spatial location and the temporal date. And you can query some patches using a region of interest, for instance. And the goal of this process is to export some TF records files that are basically some patches that we extract using GDAL. And we export them with TensorFlow in some format that is well known by TensorFlow, which is, I believe, some Google Protobuf-based stuff, and which we can use later easily when we train the models. So that was the second step. This step basically consists in generating a big data set from patches. And in the third step, it's quite simple. We just train the model and we evaluate it against a validation data set, which we don't use in the training. And we derive the metrics I told you just before, the mean squared error, etc. And if we are happy with the model, we can export it. And finally, in the last step, we can use this model to apply it on the images and generate some cloud-free images, if the model was trained to remove cloud in images, of course. So now I will explain a bit more specifically how this works with concrete example. In our study, we benchmarked a few networks that are well known in the literature. So we used this one, which is interesting because it's quite simple. In fact, it's a network that inputs one optical image, which has a lot of clouds, or not, one synthetic aperture radar image that is likely acquired in the same near the same date of the optical image. And it tries to reconstruct the optical image, in particular the missing areas below the clouds. So you can see the paper reference here. My computer is heating, so I don't know why is this. Okay. And it's quite a simple example, so it's interesting. You will see. So the so-called acquisition layout is something that allows to describe how we want the patches to be extracted to create the dataset. So as you can see here, we have one damaged optical image and one synthetic aperture radar image. So this is one, what we call one single acquisition. So this acquisition here describes that we want one cloudy image. So one optical image with let's say between 10 and 90% of clouds, and across the long one synthetic aperture radar image. And we want that these two dates here are like less than 12 hours or 10 hours, it depends. And we also want one completely cloud-free image to train the network here to reconstruct the damaged one. So we want one optical image that is that has no cloud, meaning between 0 and 0% clouds. And we don't need one Sentinel-1 image, so we just want a single optical image, which is acquired the closest to the cloudy image. In our case, we just specify a time range between plus 7 days and minus 7 days, because I believe that the Sentinel-2 on our study site were like, there is one image every 7 days, I think. So once we have created this acquisition layout, we can run the program that builds the dataset and extract all these patches, which will be stored in a TensorFlow records files. Sorry. This is some results of the dataset. We had two study sites, one in France and one in Africa, and the first dataset has 6 tiles, and the second has 10 tiles. And we use every images available since the launch of the Sentinel sensor. So that's a lot of images, 10K images, something like that, for the optical images. And here you can see the density of patches that we can extract using this acquisition layout. Of course, there is some areas where we cannot find the images, but that's not a problem because we have enough samples here to train the network. As you can see in the Africa dataset, we have enough samples everywhere, so that's cool, but not a problem. We can train a network on these patches and still apply it on only this kind of acquisition. So we would have more sample in the inference step. So the next step is to train the network. So we have extract the data set, and then we can run the training of the model. We can follow the training using the TensorBoard, and we can look on some preview images, look at the metrics, etc., etc. And once it's done, we can export the model into the CVED model format and use it at inference in one application, which is this is done by the Orfeo Toolbox using the UTBTF remote module that uses the TensorFlow to process the images in a streamable way, meaning that you can have big images. It's not an issue. The program will process it tile by tile using the Orfeo Toolbox streaming strategy. So here you can see the result with the first network that we have benchmarked for the study. So it works quite well. It's amazing, but when you have a thick cloud, you can see that the image is a bit blurry. So that's not the subject here. We are not here to talk about the result, but more about the software that we have built to perform the study. And I will try to quickly show you. Yes, I have time. Another example, which is a bit more complex. So this is another deep learning-based approach where instead of having one single synthetic aperture radar optical at the input, we have three inputs. We have three different acquisitions in a time domain. And the network will try to use all the available content of the input to reconstruct the image acquired at the central date here. So we call this image the T minus one, this one the T, and this one the T plus one acquisition. So here is the reference of the paper if you want to check out. And this is what we create in terms of acquisition layouts. we have three acquisition layouts. The first one is the one that we use for the training of the network. So as you can see, we just need some cloud image at T minus one, T and T plus one with a synthetic aperture radar image. And we want also a completely cloud-free image in order to be able to train the network here. So it's a target image. So that's great. This acquisition layout here allows us to train the network. And we create two other acquisition layouts. So this one and this one use some cloud-free image at input and some cloudy, so moderately cloudy for this one and heavily cloudy for this one. And thus allowed us to compare the decloud approach, so the convolutional neural network approach, with some classic deterministic approaches like gap filling. Gap filling is a well-known technique that interpolates in the temporal domain the available pixels to derive the missing content under the clouds. The problem of those approaches is like you have to have very precise cloud masks, and sometimes the cloud masks are not really good, and you have some artifacts in the reconstructed images. So this enables us to compare the deep learning approach and the classic one. That's why we have all this acquisition layout here. And it was really convenient for the need of our study, but it's really also convenient to train some network in particular scenarios. For instance, you have a very cloudy image and you want to force the network to train better on the very cloudy image, or a contrario, you have some very clean image and sometimes one cloudy image, so you can really select which amount of cloud you want at the input. That's just an example of application. And we train using the exact same command line, the network. We just specify another network here. So you can implement your own network. You just have to derive some class, some main class. And after that, you can implement whatever loss function you want to train the network. Etc. Whatever input you want. For instance, on this network, we use some digital elevation model to help the network process the synthetic aperture radar images from the input. And the inference of this kind of network is a bit more complex because we have to do some pre-processing of the inputs. Because, you know, in real life, we don't have a valid pixel in everywhere in the images. So you have to pre-select the pixels that you want to use. And we did that using the Orfeo toolbox because the Python API of the Orfeo toolbox is really powerful. You can chain together multiple OTB applications and form a big entirely streamable pipeline. That means that from the beginning to the end of the pipeline, you have no temporary files written on the file system. It's direct in-memory processed, and you can process very large images without the need of tiling and no edge for that. So it's really great, and you just have to build in Python some pipeline with your blocks like Legos and trick the last application of the pipeline. It will process all the data of the pipeline. So here, for instance, you will take a look in the code. We used some applications to perform the selection of no data pixel, some other application to perform some binary erosion of these masks to remove the polluted pixels of the borders of the images, because the convolutional neural networks can have a bit of some side effects, so you have to remove some pixels which are not valid. And finally, we manage the no data in the output image, etc., etc. If you process one node data pixel using a convolutional neural networks, it will likely output some strange things which we don't want to figure in the output image. So the inference pipelines are a mix of Python code for building the pipeline and C++ optimized applications to quickly access the pixels and compute some stuff from the dates, etc. And this is the result of the we have processed the entire one entire Sentinel-2 tile near Toulouse. So you can see that these dates range from the launch of the Sentinel-2 sensor to last year's November, I believe. So you can see that most of the clouds, every clouds are removed. On some images, maybe the output is a bit blurry because as before, when you don't have some exploitable content in the input image, it's very hard to retrieve very precise geometric details in the image. And that is caused by the fact that the synthetic aperture radar is not impacted by clouds, but it is not the same information as we have in the optical images. And moreover, it's really noisy, so it's very difficult to get this the original geometric information. For information, we only have processed the 4 10-meter spectral bands of the Sentinel-2 image, but we have implemented the networks which use the every spectral bands of the Sentinel-2 image and which is able also to process all these spectral bands. So that's it. Yeah, I will quickly summarize the features of the ZD Cloud software. It's a toolbox to ease the cloud removal and image reconstruction from Sentinel time series. It targets mostly researchers or engineers that want to try deep learning to for research and development application. I believe it's great, but it can be improved. And since it's open source, everything is possible. Don't hesitate to make some PR or something. And its core features are patches, query, dataset building, and the create and the training of deep nets. Also, it's possible to implement your own custom pipelines using the TB applications. And we ship the software with some already implemented deep nets ready to use against synthetic aperture radar images and optical images, and also digital elevation models. So in our study, we implemented two main families, as you show just before, multi-temporal convolutional neural networks and single-date convolutional neural networks. Unfortunately, the code is not available today because we still have some legal issues to process with the French Space Agency, but it will be announced soon on our blog. Or you can also follow us on GitHub, and it will be, of course, available on our institute's GitLab instances. I believe we'll put some APH2 license, and that's it. Thank you very much. I hope you understood what I said, everything I said, that you didn't have some technical difficulties to see the pictures and the schematics. And I'm open for questions, either now or by email. I will be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you, Remy. It was, indeed, a very clear presentation. Everything was very clear, and the images also were very nice. There is one question. What is the time step used for target image, ground truth?
We used some 7-day absolute difference. for the first network, and the second we increase a bit to 8 days because we have difficulties to have enough samples. But I saw yesterday that now there is a Landsat 9, I believe,
yes,
which is launched, and now we have one image like this every 2 years, I believe, with this constellation. So it's amazing. It opens a new perspective, and it's amazing.
That's great. I also had the same doubt because I was thinking when you reconstruct the optical image, if you use a SAR image from too long time difference, it could make some problems, no?
For the synthetic aperture radar, we use really short ranges, like 12 hours, because this must be really correlated to for the model to work, because synthetic aperture radar is really sensible to soil moisture and things like that. If you wait like 3 days, it's not that precise. So yes, we were lose with the images, the optical image, but not with the couple of synthetic aperture radar and optical images.
Okay, that's great. There is another question. How many time to process one Sentinel-2 tile?
That's really quick with most of the implemented networks. In fact, with the first architecture, so this one, I hope the guy that write the paper is not in the audience, but is the original architecture, it took like ages, but we just replaced the ResNet network by some UNet network, and UNet also has better properties because you can input the different resolution the bands at each level of the convolution. It's really quick, like I don't remember, but 5 minutes maybe for one image on all the hardware like GTX. So it's really, really quick, I believe. On NVIDIA Tesla, it's like it's matter of a minute, or it's really, really quick. We trained some very small network. We didn't build some incredible complex network because we were studying a few tiles. I think if you want to build a big model which works well at a global scale, maybe you can train a more heavy model. Maybe it will last like a bit more on one tile, but really, quite frankly, it's really quick. It's not not really, I believe it's really operational right now, and it's great.
That's nice. And so I don't see any more questions. I was also thinking if you had compared this technique, especially the cloud masking, with another algorithms like based on the temperature of clouds and other kind of ways, more physical.
No, we didn't do that. We didn't try to derive some cloud masks, even if that's possible, but we didn't try that. It would be interesting. I believe people that are working on the cloud masks should definitely look into these kind of approaches, because I believe that if we can remove clouds like this, it should be easy to also detect them quite with a fine precision. We use some cloud masks, but as metadata only on the patches. So if you have a wrong cloud information on one patch, it's not a big deal. You know, it's like a bit of a lazy supervised approach. It's not like if you have a tell, this is on cloud, you know. So it's, you can even take a scene and tell, okay, there is cloud in it, and you put it on this side, but you know, it's not a densely annotated data set for the cloud information, but that's really interesting, I believe.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for your presentation. We now will continue with the next speaker. So bye, Remy, and thank you for everything.
Thanks.
Okay, now.